Wind turbines rely on wind to produce electricity. My name is Axel Viret, and I'm an assistant professor in wind energy at TU Delft. In this video, you will learn about the wind. In particular, after this lecture, you will be able to enumerate the main sources of wind, to explain the differences in wind velocity profile between onshore and offshore wind, and also to explain how to characterize the wind through a probability density function. But first, let's look at the wind energy resource on Earth. Studies have shown that the total wind energy resource available in the lower atmosphere is roughly 200 times the current global energy demand. Compared to other sources of renewable energy, wind energy therefore comes second, after solar power, which is by far the dominant renewable energy resource. Of course, not all the wind energy potential in the lower atmosphere can be harnessed. More realistic studies have shown that if we placed wind turbines only in technologically feasible locations, therefore excluding very remote areas, Antarctica, etc., the wind energy resource is still 40 times larger than the current energy demand. This scenario will, however, never be achieved, due, for example, to policy restrictions. However, scientists in the field do believe that wind power can provide a quarter of the total energy demand worldwide. So rest reassured, the resource is available to us. But where does the wind come from? Well, the sun heats the Earth differently at different locations. This creates temperature gradients across the globe. Hot air tends to rise in the atmosphere, while cold air tends to fall towards the ground. This generates global recirculation of air between regions of different temperatures. These motions are, of course, influenced by additional factors, such as the Earth's rotation. But wind power does originate from the sun. In addition to these global motions, local effects arise due to differences in terrain. In particular, the thermal inertia of the oceans and the land are different. The latter gets heated faster during daytime. As I just mentioned, the hotter air above the land will rise, while the colder air above the sea will fall. This creates a local recirculation region between land and sea. The localized wind located towards the shore is called a sea breeze. A similar phenomenon can be observed close to mountains, where different slopes will be heated differently during the day. This will also create local recirculations of air around the mountain. So we have seen how local topography influences global and local recirculations of air. This slide illustrates some typical wind velocity profiles as a function of the altitude. The wind velocity increases from zero at the ground to a certain value in the atmosphere. The exact shape of the profile, however, depends on the local topography. Above sea, the increase will be much steeper. This means that offshore, the wind speed is more uniform with the altitude. By contrast, in urban areas, the presence of buildings and trees will slow down the wind. This means that the wind speed will reach a fairly constant value at a much higher altitude than offshore. In short, offshore wind turbines generally benefit from much stronger and uniform winds. These global and local variations are associated with different length and timescales. As you might expect, global variations occur at a global scale, that is, over distances of hundreds or thousands of kilometers. They are also associated with large timescales of the order of months, as this global recirculation will typically change with the seasons. By contrast, local effect, due, for example, to the type of terrain, will vary over short distances of the order of meters and small timescales. the sea breeze in particular, is a daily event. Whilst the turbulence created by urban obstacles changes every minute or even every second. It is therefore a good approximation to assume that the global and local effects are decoupled. Now imagine that we can measure the time evolution of the wind speed as a function of time at a specific location. The time evolution will encompass all the variations that we have just mentioned. Statistically, the wind is assumed to be stationary over intervals of 10 minutes. This means that we can divide this signal into 10-minute intervals, and for each, compute a mean velocity. We can then count how many times a certain mean velocity occurs in the signal, and place this information in a histogram. The histogram will show how often each wind speed occurs. This histogram can be more precisely represented by a continuous function, the probability density function, that shows the probability of occurrence of a given wind speed. It can be shown that the probability density function can be well approximated using a Weibull distribution. Luckily, if we cannot measure the full evolution of the wind speed, we can still characterize the wind using a predefined Weibull distribution. In the following video, we will see how these distributions can be used to estimate the energy produced by a wind turbine. To summarize, in this video, we enumerated different sources of wind with various length and timescales. We qualitatively saw how the wind velocity profile differs onshore and offshore. And we also learned that probability density functions are used to characterize variations in the wind speed. In the next video, we will explain the basics of wind power generation.